Let us go through the course policy first. You have this policy on the springboard, so you can take a printout from there. The textbook is same that you use for Thermo 1. So you might have Sengal Bowles, Thermodynamics and Engineering Approach, or Moran and Shapiro, Fundamentals of Engineering Thermodynamics. So both of these books are fine, whichever you have will work. Okay, this course is divided into four topics. The first topic is gas power cycles. Now, if you remember in Thermodynamics 1, we talk about power cycles, but those were vapor powers. That was vapor power cycle, Rankine cycle, in which working fluid is sometimes in the liquid phase and sometimes in the vapor phase. And because there is a phase change, we call it vapor power cycle. In this course, we will talk about gas power cycles, where working fluid is always in the gas phase. That is the first topic. And this topic is going to be extremely easy. If you understood Thermo 1 well, it is going to be extremely easy. Second is ideal and real gas mixtures, psychrometrics, and air conditioning. So this topic is more about applied thermodynamics. So just like we talked about refrigeration in Thermo 1, so here we will talk about air conditioning. And this topic is also very easy. Third is thermodynamic property relations. And in this topic, we will see how thermodynamic property tables are actually developed. Okay. So this topic is going to be more theoretical. And fourth is chemical reactions. That means combustion for us and internal combustion engine. So we'll talk a little bit about these. So these are the four topics in this course. And grading is, there will be quizzes, around 6 to 8 quizzes worth 20%, 3 exams worth 70%, and homework problems worth 10%. There is absolute grading without any curve, and you have the scale here. A is 90 plus, A negative is 83 plus, so that is the scale. And traditionally in this course, class average has been around B plus. So if it turns out on some test, you get very low marks and class average is poor, I'm going to just give bonus points. So class average is at least greater than B. Okay, now quizzes. Each quiz will be given during a class. It will be about 25 minutes long. And quizzes will always be open book, open notes. But you will have short time, only 25 minutes. So you should have a good understanding of the course to do a quiz. And the quiz problem will be similar to the homework problems. Okay, so those are the quizzes. Okay, examinations. Exams in this course will be closed book, closed notes. But you will be allowed to use a formula sheet. And there will be 3 exams. I have written here, there'll be one exam each on topics 1, 2, and 4. So one exam will be on gas power cycles, one on air conditioning, and one on combustion and IC engines. There will not be any exam on thermodynamic property relations, only 3 exams. And policy for homework, if you took Thermo 1 with me, I'm going to follow the same policy, so I'm just going to read it. Along with the homework, the solutions to the homework problems will be supplied to you. The homework problems are to be attempted, graded by you, and turned in prior to the due date. So you can use the solutions because you will have the solutions if you get stuck. You can refer to the solutions, then do it yourself and grade it yourself. And you will get points for attempting the problem and not necessarily for doing it right. So what it means is on a particular homework, say out of 100 points, when you graded yourself, you got 50, but you had attempted all the problems. So you will get 100 points for your grade. So there is no point in cheating there. So the grading is just for evaluating yourself. Okay. And there are instructions for grading. You grade each problem out of 10 points, grade with a pen, and circle or comment your mistakes. If you turn in a homework without grading, then there might be a 20% penalty. So this grading is important. Okay, then class examples. These are the examples I will be doing in the class. And the statement of the problems will be on the springboard, so you can bring a printout to the class. And finally, the syllabus. I have written here, you have chapter 9 and 12 to 15 from Sengal Bowles, or if you have Moran Shapiro, that is chapter 9 and 11 to 13. And then there is detailed description of the course, like gas power cycles. You can see what are the topics we will be covering. Okay, then in gas mixture, psychrometrics and air conditioning, and thermodynamic property relations, and in chemical reactions. Okay, so we'll begin with the first topic, that is gas power cycles. And I have prepared these notes already, because this way it is going to be very efficient. And I will be able to cover in 1 hour what usually takes 2 hours. So I have these notes, and these will be available on the springboard, these notes. Okay, now the gas power cycles, you know from Thermo 1 that the purpose of a power cycle is to convert thermal energy into mechanical energy. So we want work output. And the cycle is called a gas power cycle if the working fluid always remains in gas phase. And in this category, we have several internal combustion engines. For example, spark ignition engine, compression ignition engine, and then gas turbine engine, and also jet propulsion. All those come in the category of gas power cycles. And actually here, your life is going to be very easy in comparison to Thermo 1. Because in gas power cycles, working fluid is always in gas phase, so you have to just deal with ideal gases. It won't be like liquid and superheated vapor and two-phase mixture where you have to deal a lot with property tables, so it is going to be much more easier here. So first, let us see a very brief description of spark ignition or compression ignition engine. And you know this already, but just for completeness, I'm going to describe it briefly. So here what you see is, it's a sketch of a cylinder with a piston. And these are the valves. And depending on the engine, you have here a fuel injector, if it is a compression ignition engine, or a spark plug, if it is spark ignition engine. So that is just a basic sketch. And piston moves up and down in this, it reciprocates. The topmost position of the piston, when it is closest to the cylinder head, this is cylinder head, when this piston is closest to the cylinder head, that position is called TDC, top dead center. And when the piston is at the bottom position, which is farthest from the cylinder head, that position is called BDC, bottom dead center. So the piston is going to reciprocate between TDC and BDC. The distance traveled by the piston in going from TDC to BDC, this distance is called stroke. And the volume corresponding to this stroke, that is going to be pi by 4 d square times this stroke. That is the displacement volume. So that is the basic terminology. And the volume at top dead center, that is the minimum volume of the combustion chamber. This is the combustion chamber. It will have minimum volume when piston is at top dead center. And that volume is called clearance volume. When it is at bottom dead center, it will have maximum volume. And we also define compression ratio, R, which is just the ratio of these two volume, maximum volume to minimum volume, that is compression ratio. So that is a basic terminology. You are already conversant with this. Okay, let us look at a four-stroke spark ignition engine on PV diagram. That is pressure volume diagram. And the volume is going to change between TDC and BDC. So these two lines are the boundaries, the maximum volume and the minimum volume. And there are four strokes. This 1 to 2, that is intake. So from outside, if it is spark ignition engine, it will be a homogeneous mixture of air and fuel. So that enters the cylinder. 2 to 3 is compression, so it is compressed. And at some point during compression, there is spark. And because of this spark, a flame is generated, and that flame, as that flame progresses, it consumes fuel oxidizer mixture, and that leads to energy release and pressure rise. So at this point, there is spark and combustion continues. So this 2 to 3, that is called compression stroke. And then it looks like this, 3 to 4, that is called power stroke or expansion stroke. And 4 to 1 is exhaust. So exhaust valve is opened and it is exhausted. And again, 1 to 2 fresh charge comes into it. Okay. So that is a basic four stroke SI engine. And if you see it, actually, this is not a cycle. We can say it is a mechanical cycle because in a mechanical sense, these four strokes, intake, compression, power, and exhaust, they go in a cycle. They repeat again and again. But it is not a thermodynamic cycle because there is intake and there is exhaust. So it is not a cycle. Mass is going into the system from outside, and then system is exhausting mass to the surrounding. So it is actually not a thermodynamic cycle. Okay. So that is four-stroke SI engine. And if we have, instead of SI engine, we have compression ignition engine, it is going to look very similar. But instead of spark, at this point, we will have fuel injection. Fuel injection will begin. And so the compression is just of air. And at some point, when temperature is high enough due to compression, fuel is injected and fuel auto-ignites. So we don't need any external means of initiating combustion like a spark. Fuel just auto-ignites, there is energy release, and it looks similar to this. Okay. Now, the actual engine is very, very complicated, and I have listed a few complications here. So, the system is very complicated because one is there is a lot of turbulence. Actually, turbulence is desirable in engines because turbulence accelerates the rate of combustion, because there is very short time. The whole cycle is executed very fast, few thousand RPM we know. So there is a lot of turbulence. So it is complicated from fluid mechanics point of view. Then we have spray, and spray itself is very complicated because what we are injecting is liquid. This liquid first atomizes, so that means it breaks up into very, very fine droplets, like of the order of maybe say from 20 to 100 micron. So in that range, we get spray, but it is still liquid. There is evaporation, so it goes from liquid to vapor phase fuel. And it has to mix with surrounding air. Along with that, chemical reactions are going on. It is not that there is one reaction. There are thousands of reactions going on. And the working fluid, it keeps on changing. Because say in a compression ignition engine, the intake is air, but then we are injecting fuel and it burns. So we get combustion products. So working fluid keeps on changing continuously. And there is no spatial homogeneity. Actually, there is spatial inhomogeneity. So at any time instant, if you see the temperature field inside or the composition field inside, things are very non-homogeneous. So it is actually a very complicated system. And A detailed analysis of this is done through CFD. It requires a lot of understanding. But in this course, we are going to study this system at the simplest possible level. Okay, so we are going to make a lot of assumptions, and at the simplest possible level, we will understand this system. So let us look at the assumptions. So the assumptions for a simple analysis. These assumptions are called air standard assumptions. And these are, the first assumption is that we say the working fluid is air, an ideal gas that circulates in a closed loop. So here what we are saying is, in reality, working fluid keeps on changing. I already explained that, but here we are saying that working fluid is air, and or we could say it is some other gas, that's fine, but it is an ideal gas and it remains, its composition does not change, okay? And it circulates in a closed loop. By saying that it circulates in a closed loop, we are saying that now it is actually a thermodynamic cycle. It is a thermodynamic cycle. In this case, it is a closed system. So we are saying there is no intake because the working fluid circulates in a loop. There is no exhaust. Okay. And also we are saying there is no combustion because we are saying working fluid is air. Okay, so that means there is no combustion. So to explain that a little bit. So in reality, what we have is okay, if we say this is engine, okay, so you have fuel and air coming in, and then there are combustion products that are exhausted. Okay, so it is not a cycle. But now what we are saying is, based on these assumptions, there is nothing going in and out, or you can say, if you want to say that air goes in, and then if you want to say air comes out, so it goes back in. Okay, so effectively nothing goes in and out. It becomes a closed system. There is no intake, no exhaust, and there is no combustion. Okay, so that is first assumption. Okay, now, but in reality, there is combustion. So we have to simulate the effect of combustion in some way. Okay. And the effect of combustion is that the chemical energy of fuel is converted into thermal energy. So this is just like heat addition. And because of that, second assumption is that combustion is replaced by heat addition. So this is, by this, we are simulating combustion. Just very, very simple thing. And finally, exhaust is replaced by heat rejection, okay? Because exhaust has, there are two things to exhaust. One is the gases itself, they are going out, and those gases are at high temperature. So there is energy with those gases that is leaving the system. And if we are saying there is no exhaust, then we have to replace the effect of exhaust, which was loss of that energy which was in the exhaust by some process. So we replace exhaust by heat rejection. And the idea is, at the end of exhaust, the working fluid will come to the same state that is at the first, at the, okay, I'll explain that later on. It will be clear when I explain the details of the cycle. Okay, so that is the third assumption. And fourth is, we say all processes are internally reversible. There can be external irreversibility, but they are internally reversible. So for our purpose, what that means is we have quasi-static processes. That is one. There is, at any instant, there is uniform temperature and pressure inside the system. That is the requirement for, you know, for thermal and mechanical equilibrium, and there is no friction. So all processes are internally reversible. So with these four assumptions, okay, we'll see how actually the whole system, the whole engine becomes very, very simple. Okay. And these are called air standard assumptions. Okay, now first let us look at the spark ignition engine. So here again, you see the PV diagram, and we have intake, compression, expansion, and exhaust. So those are the four strokes. Now, with air standard assumptions, what we will say is that there is no intake, no exhaust. So get rid of this portion altogether. That is one. Okay. So you see this PV diagram based on air standard assumption. So we are starting from, say, 1. 1 to 2 is compression. Because there is no intake, we are starting from 1, and this is compression. Okay. And now, there was combustion here, but we are replacing combustion by heat addition. And in this case, we have this from 2 to 3. You see, at constant volume, pressure increases. That is because we are saying there is heat addition from 2 to 3. Okay, so we have replaced combustion process by heat addition at constant volume. 3 to 4 is expansion, and then because we don't have any exhaust, we have replaced exhaust in this case by heat rejection from 4 to 1. So what you see here is at constant volume, 4 to 1 volume remains constant. At constant volume, pressure decreases. So that means there is heat rejection. So these are the four processes. And to be more specific, in this particular case, we are taking process 1 to 2 as isoentropic compression. Okay, so entropy remains constant from 1 to 2. That means the process is adiabatic. Okay, because if you remember from thermo 1, okay, we have change in entropy of a system. It is due to two reasons. One is due to heat transfer. We write that term as delta Q over T. And other term is due to irreversibilities. That is called entropy generation. So sometimes we use symbol S gen for that. Sometimes we use symbol sigma. So regardless of what you use. So change in entropy is due to heat transfer and due to irreversibilities. But here, our one of the air standard assumptions is that we are saying that all processes are internally reversible. So that means there is no entropy generated in the system. So this term is zero. Okay, and we are saying process is isoentropic. So this is also zero. So that means this term is zero. Okay, so there is no heat transfer. It is adiabatic. Okay, so let us see these processes. So 1 to 2, we have isoentropic compression, or you can say adiabatic compression. 2 to 3 is constant volume heat addition. 3 to 4 is isoentropic expansion, or you can say it is adiabatic expansion. And 4 to 1 is constant volume heat rejection. Okay, so with air standard assumptions, now we got this cycle, and this cycle is called Otto cycle. Okay. Now another thing is, actually, see here, what we are saying is all heat addition, which happens from 2 to 3, happens at constant volume. Okay. And for how long piston is there at top dead center? Okay, for, you can say, just negligibly small amount of time piston is there. So all heat addition happens instantaneously. The moment piston is at the top dead center, immediately you have all heat addition. So you have, you can say you have infinitely fast combustion. Okay, reality is not like that. In reality, what happens is after this spark, heat release happens over a period of time. So starting from this point, okay, maybe up to this point, heat release continues. But we have replaced that heat release by a single heat addition at constant volume. And similarly, heat rejection by heat rejection at constant volume. And this cycle is called Otto cycle. Okay. And this cycle is used if we want just the simplest possible analysis of spark ignition engine. So this is, you can say, this represents spark ignition engine based on air standard assumptions. Okay, that is Otto cycle. Okay, now let us look at compression ignition engine. So you see again on the PV diagram, we have intake, compression, expansion, and exhaust. And in this case, we have fuel injection that begins at this point, and fuel is injected for certain duration and heat release continues. Say heat release starts at this point and it continues up to say this point, it continues. Okay. And to mimic this based on air standard assumptions, we have a cycle like this. So again, we don't have any intake, okay, no exhaust. Combustion will be replaced by heat addition and exhaust by heat rejection. So here what you see is 1 to 2, that is compression. Now heat addition for compression ignition engine we take at constant pressure. So this 2 to 3. So here what you see is volume is increasing, but pressure is not decreasing. This is because we are saying there is heat addition. Okay, so 2 to 3 is heat addition. 3 to 4 is expansion, and 4 to 1 is exhaust. We have heat rejection. And this cycle is called diesel cycle. Okay, so diesel cycle, you can say it represents a compression ignition engine based on air standard assumptions. That is called diesel cycle. And the difference between Otto and diesel cycle is that in Otto cycle, you have heat addition at constant volume, but in diesel cycle, we have heat addition at constant pressure. That is the only difference. And the reason for historically taking it in this way is because actually in compression ignition engine, okay, we see a region which is somewhat flat here. So we want to have, if we want to do a very simple analysis of this, we want to say, okay, let me take heat addition at constant pressure because it looks like we have a zone which is at constant pressure here. But in spark ignition engine, we have heat release, okay, a lot of heat release very close to the top dead center. So we say, okay, for simple analysis, I'm just going to take heat addition at constant volume. Okay. So let us look at the four processes of a diesel cycle. So 1 to 2, we have isentropic compression, or you can say adiabatic compression. 2 to 3 is constant pressure heat addition. 3 to 4 is isentropic expansion or adiabatic expansion. And 4 to 1 is constant volume heat rejection. So those are the four processes. So Otto cycle and diesel cycle, which are based on air standard assumptions. Okay, then we have dual cycle. So dual cycle is like this. So we have, this is, you can say, isentropic compression, and we have some heat addition at constant volume, and then some heat addition at constant pressure. Okay. Then there is isentropic expansion, and finally heat rejection at constant volume. So this is called dual cycle because we have some heat addition at constant volume and some at constant pressure. And we can say that Otto and diesel cycles are special cases of dual cycle, because if we make this zero, it will become a diesel cycle. And if we make this heat addition zero, it will become Otto cycle. So those are special cases of this. Okay. And now see, the situation is, what we have is, in all these cases, whether it is Otto cycle, diesel cycle, or dual cycle, all we have is just a piston cylinder device, and piston is moving back and forth, that's all. So it's a closed system. So energy analysis of this is going to be very easy. A closed system undergoing some processes, isentropic compression or expansion or constant volume heat addition, heat rejection. So analysis is going to be very easy. So let us look at energy analysis of Otto cycle. Okay, so again, you see Otto cycle here, that is adiabatic compression, then constant volume heat addition, adiabatic expansion, and constant volume heat rejection, okay, on PV diagram. Okay, now let us, when you look at the energy analysis, so for process 1 to 2, okay, it is isentropic, entropy is constant, and the process is internally reversible. That means it is adiabatic. I already explained that. So heat transfer is zero. And first law for closed system is we have delta U is Q minus W. Okay, that is first law for a closed system, where if you remember, we have sign convention. Okay, here I have shown you have sign convention for Q and W. So if this represents the system, the sign convention is heat transfer is positive if it is into the system, and it is negative if it is out of the system. And work is positive if work is done by the system, and if it is negative if work is done on the system. Okay, so in this equation we have this sign convention when we write delta U is Q minus W. So for the process from 1 to 2, Q is 0. So that gives W is just negative delta U. That becomes negative M U2 minus U1. M is the mass of the system, which remains constant because now it is a closed system. So this U represents total internal energy, and lowercase u, that is specific internal energy. You know these things. You must distinguish between lowercase u and uppercase u. So that is work is negative M U2 minus U1 from 1 to 2. But we know that from 1 to 2, actually, we don't have work output. We have work input because you see volume is decreasing. Okay, so surrounding is doing work on the system. We have work input. But this expression is work output. So I can say if I want to write work input, I'm just going to take away this negative sign. So work input is M U2 minus U1. So for process from 1 to 2, we have work input. There is no heat transfer. You can also write this on a per unit mass basis. So if you divide this with M, you get W in. Okay, this is lowercase W. Then you write that as U2 minus U1. So that is process 1 to 2. Okay, then other processes, those are very simple here. Process 2 to 3, that is a constant volume process. That means there is no work transfer because boundary work is integral PdV. If volume is constant, there is no work. So based on first law, you apply delta U is Q minus W, you will get heat transfer in is M U3 minus U2. Then process 3 to 4 is adiabatic, and you will get work output is M U3 minus U4. And 4 to 1 is constant volume, so there is no work, and we will get heat rejection. Q out is M U4 minus U1. Okay, so just very simple energy analysis here. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, so yeah. So one thing you can notice here is whenever we are writing it, work in, okay, Q in or work out, then actually after that there is no sign convention. We are taking all these as positive. Okay, if you write W as negative MU2 minus U1, there is sign convention associated with this. But here I'm saying, what is the direction of this W? This is work input. So this is MU2 minus U1. So all terms here are positive. This is work input. We have work input from 1 to 2. Work output from 3 to 4. Q in from 2 to 3. And Q out from 4 to 1. So we are not writing just W and Q. We are so that all terms are positive. Okay, we are indicating which term is in, which term is out. It turns out it is easier to deal with it in this way. And we can write net work, that will be work output minus work input. So that is net work for the cycle. And this will also be equal to Q in minus Q out. So this is net heat transfer in, because it is a cycle. For a cycle, net heat transfer in is equal to net work output. Okay. And we can define a thermal efficiency. Thermal efficiency is net work output over Q in. So we already have expressions for, if you see here, we have all the expressions. We have for work input, work output, Q in, Q out. So we can use those expressions and substitute here. So you just substitute the terms here and you get that the efficiency of the cycle is given by this expression. These are just internal energies. So that is energy analysis of this. Okay, now before we work further with this, I'm going to review briefly a few things about ideal gases, because the working fluid here is ideal gas. Some of you might have forgotten after thermo 1. So this is just a brief review of ideal gases. Okay, ideal gas law is PV equals RT, where this V is, this is lowercase v, that is specific volume, and R is gas constant, which is defined as Ru over M, where Ru is universal gas constant. Its value is constant, you know, 8.314 joule per mole Kelvin. And M is molecular weight of the gas. So this gas constant depends on the gas because of this molecular weight. We can write this in different ways. We can write this as PV equals MRT. Now this is uppercase V because we got M here. Or we can write PV equals NRUT. This RU is universal gas constant, and N is now number of moles. Okay, so you have to be consistent when you are writing ideal gas law. Don't write P uppercase V equals RT. And when we are doing energy analysis or analysis of different processes for ideal gases, there are two approaches, and the problem will specify what you have to do. One is, if we treat specific heat as constant, okay, the problem will say that take specific heat as constant. Then we can write change in internal energy. For example, U2 minus U1 is just CV T2 minus T1. Change in enthalpy, H2 minus H1, is CP T2 minus T1. So we just need values of CV and CP. And CP minus CV is R, that is always true. And CP over CV, the ratio of these two specific heats, we use symbol K for that. Okay. So you see, out of these three things, K, CP, and CV, only one is independent. If one is given, you can work out others. For example, if CP is given, then you can use this relation to get CV. Because you will know what is the gas constant for that particular gas. You know CP. You can use this to get CV. And then you have CP and CV, you can get K. So only one is independent. Okay. And another is, when we have isentropic process, say we have isentropic process from 1 to 2. Okay. Now, if you want details of this, you refer to the textbook. We discuss in detail in Thermo 1. But then these relations are valid. P1 V1 to the K is P2 V2 K. T1 V1 to the K minus 1 is T2 V2 to the K minus 1. Or P1 1 minus K T1 K is P2 1 minus K T2 K. Okay, these relations, actually they represent just one relation put in different ways by using ideal gas law. Okay, so this is valid for isentropic process. Don't use it otherwise. If two states are related by an isentropic process, between those two states you can use this relation. So these, this approach you are going to take if it says that CP is constant. And you are going to need CP, CV, or K, just one of these. Okay, you don't need all three. If one is given, you can work out all others and do analysis based on this. Other possibility is, the problem says that CP is variable. Okay. In that case, you'll have to use tables. And there are tables in the appendix of the book. You have used those in Thermo 1 also. Those tables for air or any other ideal gas. Those are in this form. Okay, you have temperature, internal energy, enthalpy, and you have columns for PR and VR. So the table is like this. Okay, so if the problem says CP is variable, then you have to read U and H values from the table. You have to read from this table. So if you are given the temperature, corresponding to that temperature, you can read U or H. Or if you are given U, you can find temperature corresponding to that. And if you have isentropic process, say from 1 to 2, okay, then states 1 and 2, they are related by this expression. V2 by V1 equals VR2 by VR1. And the values of VR, you are going to read from this table. Okay. And P2 by P1 is PR2 by PR1. Okay, so if CP is variable, then you are going to take this approach. And if CP is constant, okay, then you are going to use these relations. Okay, but it is very easy to deal with ideal gases. Okay, so this is the expression we got for efficiency of an Otto cycle. And we cannot do anything with it further if we take CP as variable. Okay, because if CP is variable, we have to read the values of U1, U2, U3, and U4 from the table. For that, we need temperatures. So we'll have to leave this expression as it is. It does not give us any insights about on what factors the efficiency depends. We don't get any insight. But if we take specific heat as constant, then we can reduce this expression to a very simple form. So let us see that. That is the advantage of taking CP as constant. We get very simple expressions. Okay, so when CP is constant, we get closed form solution. Okay, so see, this is again the Otto cycle 1, 2, 3, 4 on PV diagram. And let us say we are given temperature at 1, compression ratio, and K. Okay, now see, process 1 to 2 is isentropic. And it is related, if you are taking specific heat as constant, then I'm using the isentropic expression for an ideal gas. T1 V1 K minus 1 is T2 V2 K minus 1. You can write it in this form. And V1 over V2, that is compression ratio. So T2 is T1 R to the K minus 1. Okay. And similarly, we have 3 to 4 is isentropic. Just like 1 to 2 is isentropic, we have 3 to 4 as isentropic. So based on that, similarly, you will get T3 is T4 R to the K minus 1. And you can write based on these two expressions, you see, T2 over T1 is actually T3 over T1. T2 over T1 is T3 over T4. So temperature ratio during compression is same as temperature ratio during expansion. And now look at the expression for thermal efficiency. 1 minus U4 minus U1 over U3 minus U2. We have this expression already. So this becomes 1 minus U4 minus U1 we can write as CV T4 minus T1 if CP is constant, and U3 minus U2 as CV T3 minus T2. So this CV cancels, and we can manipulate this expression. We can take T1 outside, so this becomes T4 over T1, this becomes T3 over T2. And T4 over T1 equals T3 over T2. You can see that based on this expression. If you rearrange it, you'll see T4 over T1 is T3 over T2. So these two terms will cancel. And this will just becomes 1 minus T1 over T2. Okay, thermal efficiency just becomes that. And that becomes 1 minus 1 over compression ratio to the power K minus 1. Because this T1 and T2 are related based on this compression ratio. Okay, so we got a very simple expression that thermal efficiency for an Otto cycle, when specific heat is constant. If you take specific heat as variable, then we cannot get this expression. We have to use values from table. So thermal efficiency for Otto cycle when specific heat is constant is given by this simple expression. So it depends on compression ratio and on the ratio of specific heat K. So just on these two parameters, okay. And if you plot this expression, so here you see this is thermal efficiency versus compression ratio. If compression ratio is 1, thermal efficiency will be 0. And as compression ratio increases, you see thermal efficiency increases. And you see here there are different curves. Okay, let us say this curve corresponds to K equals 1.3. Okay, this is for K equals 1.4. This is, let us say this is for K equals, okay, say 1.5. So as the value of K increases, thermal efficiency increases. And as compression ratio increases, thermal efficiency increases. Okay, so we got that very simple expression for Otto cycle. And typically, you know, spark ignition engines, they operate around compression ratio of 10. Okay, maximum maybe 11 or 12. They won't go beyond 12. That is because of the problem of knocking at high compression ratio. Okay, so let me explain that briefly. What is this knocking? You may already know, but I'm going to explain that briefly. Okay, let us say this represents, okay, I'm just drawing an arbitrary shape. This represents combustion chamber in which combustion is happening. And let us say, okay, there is spark plug here. And after spark, a flame is, the purpose of spark is to give us a flame, and that flame propagates. Let us say at any instant, flame location is here. Okay, so this flame is propagating. This side is, we have, okay, burned gas. So fuel oxidizer mixture has already burned and heat release has happened. And on this side we have okay, unburned gas. Okay, and this flame is propagating in this direction. Okay, now if this flame propagates and consumes this charge, then the combustion is gradual because the flame has okay finite propagation speed. So the heat release will be gradual. Okay, because as flame propagates, there is heat release. But it can happen that this region, okay, which is at, don't have it, okay, this region is at high pressure and high temperature, okay, and chemical reactions are already going on there. So because of high pressure and temperature, it can auto-ignite, you can say it explodes, just auto-ignites before this flame consumes it gradually. And if it auto-ignites, then all the energy of this mixture here, it is released instantaneously. And that leads to very high rate of pressure rise, and there is going to be a pressure wave bouncing back and forth in the cylinder. So you'll see large oscillations in the cylinder pressure measurement. So that is called knocking, and it is very detrimental for the engine. So as compression ratio increases, then that, because this mixture is now at high pressure and high temperature because of higher compression ratio, its tendency to auto-ignite also increases. Okay, and it may auto-ignite before it is consumed by the flame. That is called knocking. So there is a limit on the compression ratio, so they won't go definitely beyond 12 spark ignition engine. Okay, so that is the efficiency plot we already discussed. And actually historically, when spark ignition engines, those were invented first, compression ratio was less than 5. Because with the fuel that was available at that time, even at compression ratio 5, that fuel was leading to knocking. Okay, then what we have today, that is a reformulated gasoline. So it has higher octane rating, which actually represents resistance to auto ignition. So it can operate at compression ratio up to 12. And historically, because spark ignition engines, they did not have very high efficiency because compression ratio was limited to less than 5 when they were introduced. When compression ignition engines were introduced, that was a big leap, because compression ignition engines are not limited by compression ratio, because there is no problem of knocking there. Okay, so immediately compression ratio went up from less than 5 to, I don't know the number, but it went up. So it was a big leap in terms of engines. So the analysis we did here and the efficiency we got here, it is based on a lot of assumptions. And the actual engine has actually lower thermal efficiency, okay, due to several factors, due to various irreversibilities. In the analysis, we say there are no internal irreversibilities, but due to irreversibilities, okay, due to friction and due to pumping work. Pumping work is work done during the intake and exhaust stroke. So we have to do the engine has to do some work to get air into the system and to exhaust combustion products out of the system. So that is the work done by the engine. And in the analysis, we said that work is zero because we did not consider any intake or exhaust stroke. So because of these things, and along with these, we also said that combustion happens at top dead center. For auto cycle, we said that it happens at constant volume at top dead center. In reality, that is not the case. It happens over a finite duration, not instantaneously at top dead center. Because of that, also efficiency decreases. So you may get, based on the equation we got, you may get that the thermal efficiency for a particular compression ratio is 60%. Okay, but in reality, maybe it will be in the range of, say, 30% or maximum 34-35%. Okay, so that was analysis for auto cycle. Okay, now one term which is very important for engines is that is called mean effective pressure. And this is actually a measure of how well engine displacement is used. Okay, how well engine displacement is used. So it is actually the mean effective pressure. This is a normalized parameter. For example, let us say I give you two engines, and you are saying that at a given RPM, let us say at 1000 RPM, both engines have same power. Okay, both engines have same power. So does that mean that both engines are equally well designed if they have same power? Really not necessary. Maybe one engine is very heavy, other engine is very light, and still they are giving same power. Okay. So what we should compare is, instead of comparing power, we can compare power per unit weight of the engine. And if power per unit weight for an engine is high, that means the weight of the engine is utilized by the designer effectively, because for less weight, you are getting more power. Okay, so it tells us how effectively the weight of the engine was utilized. So when we say mean effective pressure, we want to see how well the displacement of the piston is utilized. So if two engines have same power, but say one engine has displacement of 1000 cc, and other engine has displacement of 2000 cc, and they are giving us same power. Okay, what it actually means is the engine that has displacement of 2000 cc is not well designed, because it is taking more displacement to produce same power at a given RPM. Okay, so I hope you get the idea. What is this mean effective pressure? So the way it is defined is, it is work output. This is net work per cycle. Okay, so this work output, and we are normalizing this by the displacement volume, which will be the maximum volume minus minimum volume. So this will be the volume at the bottom dead center minus top dead center, which is the displacement volume. So this is work per unit displacement, and it turns out to be, the units turn out to be pressure, So we call it sort of pressure. It is called mean effective pressure. And you can also think of it in this way. So in the PV diagram, this is auto cycle. And let me label these, say 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so area under 1, 2, that is integral PdV for 1, 2, 2, that represents work input. And area under 3, 4, that represents work output. So this area enclosed by the cycle, okay, this area is actually the net work. Okay, this is net work per cycle. When cycle is executed once, we get this much work. Okay. Now we can think of on a PV diagram, okay, same volume. So let us say this represents V1 and this is V2 for same change in volume. Okay, consider a fictitious pressure, let us say at this level, fictitious pressure. And if this pressure, okay, pushes the piston from this volume to this volume, how much work we will get? We will get this much, okay, because this is integral PdV, so we'll get this work, okay. If you say this work and this work, they are equal, okay, so they have equal area, then this pressure is mean effective pressure. Because you can think of mean effective pressure, you get that idea from this equation also. It is net work over displacement volume, that is mean effective pressure. So you can also say this is like a fictitious pressure which acting on the piston during the expansion stroke will produce same work output, net work output, same net work output that is produced during the entire cycle. Okay, so that fictitious pressure, that is called mean effective pressure. So it tells us how effectively the displacement of the engine is used for getting work output. Okay. We can also draw auto cycle on temperature entropy diagram. So that diagram you see here. And the process 1 to 2, that is isentropic compression. So it is just going to be vertical, entropy remains constant, and because of compression, temperature increases. That is isentropic compression. And next process is constant volume heat addition. Okay, process 2 to 3, that is constant volume heat addition. And how that process is going to look? You can get that by the TdS relation. Okay, you know this about this relation from Thermo 1. We write TdS is du plus PdV, okay. And for an ideal gas, du is CvdT. Now, in this expression, if we say volume is constant, okay, then this term becomes zero, and you will get dTdS is T over CV. So that is what you see here. Del T, del S at constant volume is T over CV. And on TS diagram, del T del S actually represents the slope of the process, right? So the slope of a constant volume process, okay, DTDS at constant volume, that means the slope of a constant volume process on TS diagram will be given by this T over CV, okay? So start from this point now. It has certain temperature. Let us say for simplicity, CV remains constant. Okay, so as temperature increases because of heat addition, then slope will increase. So it goes like this. Temperature increases, entropy increases, and slope increases. Okay, it looks like this. That is heat addition. And 3 to 4, that is isentropic expansion. So it just comes down like this, constant entropy and temperature decreases. And 4 to 1 is constant pressure, heat rejection. Okay, and just like this, based on TdS relation, you will get this expression. Okay, it's very simple to get it, but you derive it. You'll get del T del S at constant pressure equals T over Cp. Okay, based on TdS relation, you will get like this. So the process from 4 to 1, it is a constant pressure process. And for a constant pressure process, slope is given by T over Cp. So it is going to look like this. Okay, that is process 4 to 1. Okay, let me ask you which process, or we'll do that later on. Okay, here that is not relevant. And the area under curve 2, 3, okay, that is integral TDS. Okay, let us say we do this from 2 to 3. Actually, this represents heat transfer here. Okay, because we have taken the process as internally reversible. And for an internally reversible process on a TS diagram, area under the curve represents heat addition. And similarly, Q out is actually integral TDS from, okay, I would do from 1 to 4 because I said it is Q out, so that this term is positive. Okay, that is Q out. Okay, and the area enclosed by the cycle, this area represents net heat input, which is same as net work output. So the area enclosed by the cycle here is net heat input or net work output. Okay, so we have completed the discussion on Otto cycle, and I'm going to do a problem on this. Okay, so from class examples, I don't know, it may not be visible in the recording, but this is, you can get it from the springboard. Okay, so let us look at first problem. Okay, it says compression ratio of an air standard Otto cycle is 9.5. Okay, so we are given compression ratio is 9.5. And okay, let us draw the Otto cycle. It says prior to isentropic compression, the air is at this pressure, temperature, and volume. So prior to isentropic compression, that means state one. So you are given P1 is 100 kilopascal. Okay, T1 is 35 degrees C. I'm just converting that to Kelvin. That will be 308 Kelvin, and volume is 600 cubic meter. Cubic centimeter. Okay. The temperature at the end of isentropic expansion process is 800 K. Okay, end of isentropic expansion is 4. So you are given temperature at 4 is 800 K. Using specific heat values at room temperature, and those values are given, we can get actually the value of K is 1.4. Okay, we should remember this. For air at room temperature, the value of K, specific heat ratio, is 1.4, and gas constant for air is 287. It's 287 joule per kilogram Kelvin. And based on this, we can get Cp and Cv. Okay, actually, Cv turns out to be, let me see that number. Okay, we'll find out. I'll write that later. Okay, let us see what we have to determine in this problem. It says that determine the highest temperature and pressure in the cycle. Okay, so highest temperature happens at 3. So we have to determine T3 and P3. The amount of heat transferred in kilojoule. So that will be heat transfer in. Thermal efficiency, okay, mean effective pressure, Okay, these are the things. And it says repeat the problem using variable specific heat. So let us first do it by taking specific heat as constant. Okay, we have to determine these things. Okay. Let me write down the value of CV. This will be given to you. This is 718 joule per kilogram Kelvin. Okay, now see, actually the problem can be done in different ways, okay? But see, what we have is, these are the things we know. 1 to 2 is isentropic, so isentropic relations are valid. I already gave you what those relations are. Okay, 2 to 3 is constant volume. 3 to 4 is again isentropic, we have isentropic relation, and 4 to 1 is constant volume. So we have those details. And we have ideal gas law. Based on ideal gas law, see, because PV equals RT, you can say PV over T is R. And R is a constant. Okay, so PV over T remains constant. So you can apply, you can write like this. You can say P1 V1 over T1 equals, okay, P3 V3 over T3. Because PV over T remains constant. And in this particular case, because it is a closed system, we can also write P1 V1 over T1 equals P3 V3 over T3. Okay, it does not matter. You use lowercase v here or uppercase v, because the mass of the system remains constant. Okay, so those are the tools we have. And it can be done in different ways, but let us see. So for state 1, okay, what is given is we are given P1, V1, and T1. Okay, these things are given. So that means by applying ideal gas law, it will give us M1 or M. Okay, because mass is constant. We use PV equals MRT. This will give us M. Okay, for state 2, see, we have compression ratio is given. Okay, and process 1 to 2 is constant entropy. Okay, so let us see other processes. Okay, 2 to 3 is constant volume, and 3 to 4 is again constant entropy, and we are given T4. Okay, now based on T4 you can get T3 directly, because we are given compression ratio. Okay, so see, T4 will be T3 over compression ratio to the K minus 1. Okay, because the process is isentropic. And okay, if you're not clear here, what I'm doing here is I just used T3 V3. K minus 1 is T4 V4 K minus 1. Okay, this will give us this one. Okay, so we can get T3 based on this. We have T4 and compression ratio given. That will give us T3. And we have to also determine P3. And to get heat transfer in, we will also need T2, because we'll have to determine difference in internal energy between 2 and 3. Okay, so let us, we are going to need all the temperatures. So T2 will be T1 compression ratio to the K minus 1. This is based on isentropic compression from 1 to 2. Okay. So now we just plug numbers in these. Let me do that. Okay, so T2 will be, T1 is 308 Kelvin. Compression ratio is 9.5 to the power K minus 1, that is 0.4. So you get T2 is 757.9 K. Okay. And T3, no, sorry. We need T3, T4 is given. So T3 will be T4. that is 800k time compression ratio to the k minus 1. Okay, so you get T3 is 1969k. Okay, so we got these temperatures. So we have all the temperatures now. Okay, we also need pressure at 3. It can be done in different ways. Like you can say P3 V3 over T3 equals P1 V1 over T1. Okay, we applied PV over T is constant between 1 and 3. And based on this, you can write P3 equals T3 over T1. Okay, T3 over T1 times P1 times V1 over V3. V1 over V3 is actually compression ratio. Okay, that is ratio of those volumes, compression ratio. So now we just plug numbers here. We have T1 and T3. We have P1 given in kilopascal and compression ratio. So just plug numbers here. That will give us P3 is 6072 kilopascal. You see, what we did is we just used isentropic relation. This is isentropic relation. This is isentropic relation. And here we are just using ideal gas law, okay, relating state 1 and 3. So we got this pressure. Okay, what else? We got P3, T3. We need Q in. Now, heat transfer in is from 2 to 3. That is, we have heat addition. So it will be just M U3 minus U2. So heat transfer in is M U3 minus U2. And with constant specific heat, that becomes M CV T3 minus T2. And we already have these numbers. We have T2, T3, and CV. And M we get from ideal gas law applied to state 1. Okay, M will be P1 V1 over RT1. And P1 is 100 kilopascal. You convert this to Pascal, 100 times 10 to the 3 Pascal. V1 is 600 cubic centimeter. That becomes 600 times 10 to minus 6 cubic meter. So take this in Pascal, this in cubic meter, over gas constant for air, that is 287 joule per kilogram Kelvin, and T1 is 308 Kelvin. So this gives us M is, you get 6.788 times 10 to negative 4 kilogram. Okay, that gives us M. So now we just plug numbers here. We have M, CV, T3, and T2 already. So this gives us Q in is 0.59 kilojoule. Okay, so CV was in joule. So it was divided by 1000. So we got answer in kilojoule here. That is Q in. Okay. And now thermal efficiency. In this case, it is very simple, because if you are taking specific heat as constant, this Otto cycle, it will be just 1 minus 1 over R to the K minus 1. We can just use this expression. And you have the values of R and K, you get 59.4%. Okay, that is thermal efficiency. And we have to determine mean effective pressure. Okay, mean effective pressure is defined as net work for the cycle over the displacement volume, that will be V1 minus V2. Okay. So we'll have to determine net work. We can determine net work as work output minus work input. Work output we have work output from 3 to 4. So that will be M U3 minus U4. Okay, this is work output minus work input, that is M. Work input is from 1 to 2, that will be U2 minus U1. And this becomes M CV T3 minus T4 minus T2 plus T1. Okay, so we have all the temperatures. We have all the temperatures. We have M, we have CV. So this gives network is 0.35 kilojoule. Okay. And now in mean effective pressure, okay, we can write this as network over V1 minus V2. We can write this as V1 times 1 minus V2 over V1, that is 1 over compression ratio. So V1 we already have, that is given, compression ratio is given, and we already got network. So we just substitute numbers here. Okay, and you have to be careful with units. Okay, compression ratio, it has no units. Take volume in cubic meter. Okay, this has to be in cubic meter. And if you are taking network in kilojoule, then your answer will be in kilopascal. If you take this in joule, answer will be in pascal. So just substitute numbers here and you will get this mean effective pressure is 652 kilopascal. Okay, so here we did this problem by taking Cp as constant. Okay, now let us see if we take specific heat as variable. So when Cp is variable, let me again write down, we are given T1 is 308 Kelvin, P1 100 kilopascal, T4 800 K, and compression ratio is 9.5. Okay, now the process from 1 to 2 is isentropic, and the isentropic relation when you take Cp as variable, okay, that will be Vr2 over Vr1 equals V2 over V1. It is isentropic process for an ideal gas when Cp is variable. And V2 over V1, this is 1 over compression ratio. Okay, so compression ratio is given. And we can read Vr1 from table because T1 is given at 308K. From the table, we can read Vr1. Let me write that number. Vr1 from table is 581.78. So this equation will give us Vr2. So isentropic process, we get 61.24. Okay, and once we got Vr corresponding to this Vr, we can read anything like temperature, internal energy, enthalpy. All those things are in the table. So corresponding to this Vr, we can read temperature from the table. That will be T2, where this Vr2. Okay, we read temperature from the table, that is 733.85 Kelvin. You may have to interpolate in that table, but you get this. Okay, so that is T2. Now 3 to 4 is isentropic. And just like this one, okay, you can write Vr4 over Vr3 equals V4 over V3. Okay. And V4 over V3 is actually compression ratio. V4 is compression ratio time V3. This is compression ratio. We have this. We have T4, so we can read VR4 from table. The temperature at 4 is 800 K. So at that, we read VR from table. That is 48.08. And then based on this equation, we plug numbers in this. That gives us VR3 is 5.061. And because we got VR now, corresponding to this, we can read temperature from the table. So this gives us T3 is 1668.7 K. Okay, that is T3. Okay, so we got these temperatures T2 and T3. We needed all the temperatures. Okay, the problem says we have to determine P3 also. So for that, we do ideal gas law we did previously. P1 V1 over T1 is P3 V3 over T3. Okay, we already have T1, T3, P1, and we have this volume ratio, which is compression ratio. So this will give us P3. You plug numbers in this, you get P3 is 5147 kilopascal. Okay, that is P3. Okay, and we have to determine, say, heat transfer in. Heat transfer in will be M U3 minus U2. And the values of U3 and U2 you will get from table. Okay, read those values from table. You have T2 and T3, you can read those values. And Q out will be M U4 minus U1. Okay, we can get these values also from table. That will give us Q out. And for thermal, for net work, okay, net work you can also do Q in minus Q out. That is also net work. Okay, so you substitute those numbers here, that will give you net work. And thermal efficiency is net work over heat input. In this case, alternatively, you can also write this as 1 minus Q out over Q in. Okay, so you have to plug numbers here. That will give you thermal efficiency. Don't do 1 minus 1 over R to the K minus 1, because that is true for the case when you have constant specific heat. Okay, that gives thermal efficiency. And then mean effective pressure. Okay, same formula. Mean effective pressure, that is defined as net work over V1 minus V2. Okay, just plug numbers here, that will give you mean effective pressure. Okay, so the only difference is you are reading the values of internal energy from the table, and for isoentropic process you are using these expressions, and you're reading VR values and temperature values from the table. So that is the difference. Okay, so we will stop at this point. So it turns out this lecture is actually less than 1.5 hours, but I'm sure that in this lecture we covered worth 3 normal lectures, so because things moved fast in this. So you must watch this lecture before we meet for our first class, and if you have any questions about this, we can discuss in that lecture, but I'm not going to cover these topics again. Okay, so we'll stop here.